This evening. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we come before your presence right now. We thank you for all the blessings that we have received from you, Lord. We love you, Jesus, tonight. We bring the sacrifice of praise and adoration before you, Lord. We bless your holy name, Jesus. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty word. We lift your name, Jesus, tonight. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty words. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Blessed be God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Father, heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. Let's lift it up. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty words, blessed be the Lord God. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore, who reigns forevermore, who reigns forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. He forgives us our iniquities. He heals our sickness. We love you, Jesus, tonight. We bless your holy name, Father God. Be enthroned in the praises of your people, God. And visit us wherever we are, God. up to Jesus. He heals our land, He heals our bodies. Oh, He's the Alpha and the Omega. He knows it all. We bless Your holy name, Jesus.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. You've given me life. You opened my eyes. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You entered my heart. Set me apart. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've given me life. You opened my eyes. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've entered my heart. You set me apart. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've given me life. You opened my eyes. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You entered my heart. You set me apart.
Before Him.
We love You, Lord. Thank You for choosing us. Thank You for being faithful. Even at the times when we failed, God. You are so, so good to us. So good to us, oh God. So faithful. Thank You for giving Your life to us. Thank You for calling by Our names. You set us apart, Jesus. You've given me life. You opened my eyes. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've entered my heart. You set me apart. I love You, Lord. I love.
Can be lifted up in Jesus.
You've given me life. You opened my eyes. I love You.
Let's lift it up to Jesus.
Oh, You've given me life. You opened my eyes. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've entered my heart. You set me apart. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord.
Sense this in my spirit that some of us are looking to God and asking for a confidence asking for a confidence that God is loving us. I just want to share this with us. In Jeremiah chapter 31, we read, He has loved us with an everlasting love. He loved us once for all. To each one of us. And He calls us by our name. He sets us apart for His glory. Let me sing that bridge one last time. Let's remember that God is loving us so much. Let's respond back with the love from our hearts.
Given me life, You open my eyes. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've entered my heart. You set me apart. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've given me life. Open my eyes. I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. You've entered my heart. You set me apart. I love You, Lord. You've given me life. You open my eyes. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. And thank You, Jesus. Set me free. Christ, my Savior.
Thank You, Jesus.
Thank You, Jesus. Set me free. Christ, my Savior. Rescue me.
Father, we thank You for choosing us. Thank You for loving us, Lord, with an everlasting love. Thank You for loving us even at times where we failed to be faithful to You, Lord. Thank You for being faithful to each one of us. Lord, tonight we pray that You will increase that confidence that You are loving us, Lord. We thank You, Jesus. Help us to worship You with our lives, Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Amen.
Can we just linger in that moment of awe and wonder of who Jesus is? Wherever you are, I just want to encourage you to recognize this presence of Jesus. We just respect that presence, revel in that presence right now. Mm-hmm. in your living rooms, the ground that you are standing on right now is a holy ground. It's a holy ground. So, Father, this is my prayer, this is our cry, that you would open our eyes to the wonder of who you are, God. This name that we sing about, Jesus, I pray, Father, that our eyes would open up to this, to the beauty of your name, God. Is there any other name that mankind can call and be saved? What is it about your name that brings hope to the hopeless? What is it about you that you feed the desperate and the hunger? Father, tonight I pray that you will come and stir the waters of our hearts, God. And that we may be hungry for more of you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for never giving up on us. Thank you for chasing us down with your love. In all our shortcomings, in all our unfaithfulness, Father, your steadfast love has come after me. Your steadfast love has come after me. In all my questions, in all my doubts, in all the times that I've seized your existence for that 5 minutes of pleasure, God, you've chased me down with your love. So tonight, Father, I pray, let your light shine into the most deepest and the most darkest places of our hearts, Father. Amen. I just feel like, you know, I want each and every single person, this is, says 46 people here, I want you all to know that you are not here by accident. Yes, you accepted the invitation and you joined Zoom, but it feels like I'm getting this image of where in John chapter 4, when Jesus goes to Samaria to meet this Samaritan woman. Jesus was already at the well before she came. Okay, she was already at the well. He was already at the well before she came. And the Bible says that it was not her hunger, her thirst rather, that saved her. It was Jesus's thirst that saved her. And if you go back and read that text, Jesus says, "Hey woman, I am thirsty." And that conversation leads to her being saved, in turn, the entire village being saved. So Jesus wants you to know tonight that he was already here, logged in before you logged in. And he's more thirsty for you than you are for him. And so tonight you are not here by accident or by a chance. Just know that. And he's going to love on you. He's going to pour all of his love over you and overwhelm you tonight like never before. So I just had that picture of Jesus sitting at the well and waiting for you. Every single one, every single person. So with that thought in mind, I want to introduce tonight's speaker. She's an absolutely a beautiful, wonderful person to know. She goes after the supernatural like nobody's business. She's bold and fierce in sharing the love of Jesus. It's none other than our very own Ravali from APC East. Ravali, it's over to you, Ravali.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. It's so good to see you all. I'll just share my screen. host disabled participant screen sharing. Please, someone.
Try again. Try again.
Roshan made me cry before I started talking, so I forgot half of my content.
Are you able to share your screen now?
Yes, I will be able to share. Can you see my screen, guys?
Yep. Yes.
Yeah. So today I'm bringing Disruptive Jesus to you guys. So I want to start with a question asking that what comes to your mind when you think about Jesus? You can type it on the chat or you can just tell it out. What comes to your mind when you think Jesus? Quick. Wonder, human, best friend, savior, love, sacrifice, kindness, savior, disruptive Jesus, someone. Okay, cool. There are a lot of you know, names, a lot of personally you know Jesus, his nature, characters, things, attributes. There are lots and lots and infinite things. Today I'm gonna introduce to one of the nature of Jesus, his disruptive nature. So we will go to the a small definition of what is disruptive means. It's causing trouble and therefore stopping something from continuing as usual. So basically it means that if something is going in a usual way, though some kind of external or internal force just comes and interrupts that process and it changes the course. So we will, you know why we call Jesus disruptive in nature. So in fact, the kingdom of heaven, Jesus is carrying the kingdom of heaven, and he, when he was walking on earth, he wants the kingdom of heaven to be on earth, to come to the earth. And the kingdom of heaven basically is a very dynamic in nature. So it will disrupt anything which doesn't imitate heaven. So anything in our lives or anything in this nature which is created by God, which was created by God. So the kingdom of heaven comes and disrupts whichever, whatever the things or circumstances or situations which doesn't imitate, you know, the nature of God. So we see when Jesus was born on the earth, his birth was unusual. Nobody ever before had that kind of birth. His birth was unusual. And I mean, out of a virgin womb. And then Jesus, when he walked entirely on the earth, we see so many examples how disruptive he is. He just changed the religious beliefs. He just turned the tables. He broke every chain, and he disrupted the cultural, political views, and he entirely changed the course of the history. He didn't came and he played safe, I would say. He didn't play safe at all. Wherever he stepped in, and he brought the kingdom of, he planted the kingdom of heaven there, the kingdom of God. And we are in the fallen world, and the kingdom of, there is two kingdoms, maybe we can say the kingdom of light and kingdom of darkness. When kingdom of light, you know, just collides with the kingdom of darkness, it's like always there is a conflict which happens when the kingdom of light collides with the kingdom of darkness. And it, kingdom of light is so powerful that the darkness cannot comprehend it. So that's how disruptive in nature Jesus was. And he was very violent in nature. I mean to say, he didn't use any weapons like nowadays, like a gun or a knife or something very dramatic or that can harm physically. But his weapons are grace, love, truth, mercy. And he just used those weapons, and he penetrated into the darkness and throwed light into the lives of the people and freed them, and he became the savior of this world. So I would love to share, and there are so many examples I would say, but I would love to share a story with you guys. So I think I am guessing you all are with me till now. So I want to share a story from Luke 5, 1 to 11 chapters. I would encourage you to go back and read. That is the story of Jesus calling Simon and few other, but I'm going to take only Simon in the picture right now. So that was the scenario. The context was Simon and Andrew and few of their friends went for shipping all the night, and they were trying so hard, basically the fisherman, and they went for fishing. So they went for fishing and they tried all the night. They were like, oh my God, can I catch one fish or few fish that I can go tomorrow and go to the market and sell the fish and make some money or make some fish fry, whatever they like. But what happened is when the morning came, they couldn't find one fish also. They were so tired. They were so disappointed, discouraged. Basically, finally, they are kind of wrapping up their stuff. They're cleaning their nets. Then comes Jesus. He said, okay, this is the correct time to disrupt the life of Simon. So he comes into the picture, and he's known as Rabbi that point of time that he's going places and teaching people. So that day he was on the shore and he was teaching few people, and he saw Simon and he was like, hey Simon, can I get on your boat? I just want some space to, you know, I want to teach for some time. Simon was like, okay, fine, get on the boat. And then he was like, after that he was like, okay, Simon, can you cast your net again? You know, so imagine if I was Peter that time, I was Simon that time, I would have asked, are you serious, Jesus? Are you kidding me? I did all the night. I will give him 100 reasons why I should not cast the net. I will give him so many justifications that you don't know about fishing. You are not a fisherman. I am the fisherman. I am doing it. This is my profession. You don't know that. I would try to maybe explain to him. But I love the word here, you know. Simon says, nevertheless, your word, I will cast out the net. The word, he says, nevertheless, whatever I have, whatever the experience I have being a fisherman, I don't, you know, keeping everything aside, he says, you know, nevertheless, your word, I'm going to cast out the net. So, you know, Jesus, when he disrupts our life, the first thing, one of the thing is something he makes us to do unusual. Very, very, you know, out of ordinary, I would say, out of our comfort zone, out of our perceptions, out of our experiences, which already we build our life on. So he asks us, okay, come, okay, fine. Caroline, you do something. Jesus says to you, you do something. You write some book which you never wanted to write or you hate writing. But Jesus comes and says, okay, you do that. And the result we see here, Simon, lots of fish, man. It's not normal 1, 2, or 10 fish. It's like the net is so full of fish. The net is getting, you know, it's breaking up. And the fish are so abundant. Because Jesus know the end from the beginning. That's why Jesus told cast the net. So when Jesus is interrupting or disrupting our usual ordinary ways of life or thinking or processes or anything, he knows the end from the beginning, that he knows the outcome. So he will ask, he wants to show the abundance of what he can give, and he wants to take us from glory to glory. So yeah, it would have happened in so many times in our life that when Jesus said something out of box, out of a comfort zone, out of a comfort circle, it might be, you know, coming out of a comfort circle of friends or the way we do the things or practically the way we do anything, basically. It happened to me. It was really difficult to say yes to Jesus. But when you say yes and yeah, you can see the abundance of what he wants to give you. And second thing I wanted to say, continuing the story, then I love the Peter's reaction. He immediately fell on his knees and he will be like, God, I'm a sinner. He just convicted. He was convicted of how, you know, he was a sinner. he was convicted of what is in his heart. Basically, Jesus just made him realize what's in his heart, his thoughts, his way of thinking, every perception. He made him realize that it might not be, you know, described completely outside, but he repented. Repentance means basically a change of heart, a change of turning back from something. The second thing, he brings change. He disrupts us and he brings a new heart. So when we encounter Jesus before we became a believer, so it's that we are having something old and we become new. But when you think after becoming a believer also, I practically think there are so many encounters with God which helps us to renew our heart. Every day, it helps us to renew our heart, and knowing more about him helps us to understand more about us, who we are in him, because we are his image. That really carries a life journey with God. Every day there is something new. And the third one, then happened, he repented. And what Jesus did, he didn't leave him. Okay, fine, you repented, fine, your birth in heaven is confirmed. Okay, Peter, go and do fishing again. No, he said an important thing, come follow me. He called Peter into his destiny, that which he has already prepared for him. You know, the call. He called him. He was like, come, follow me. An amazing line. I would love this as my forever tagline. It's like, he made Peter from fisherman to fishers of men. He was like, okay, Peter, come follow me. You are a fisherman, I know it, but I'm going to make you fishers of men. Peter will be like, what? What does it mean being fishers of men? Maybe he wouldn't have understood completely what exactly Jesus is saying. After seeing the biggest miracle of his life, he will be in that shock itself. Okay, fine. I have a little small story with it. It's a little funny. So I was applying for Bible College, ABC Bible College 2 years back, and I literally want to go to Bible College because I want to study Bible. I don't know anything, not even John 3:16. Now though I bi-hatted because I felt guilty, like everyone knows John 3:16, I don't know. So I went for an interview, that Pastor and Pastor Jiggs and Diana are there. And then I went inside and Pastor asked me, why you want to join Bible College, Dawley? I said, I want to read Bible. I literally said that. He laughed and he was like, okay, fine. What do you think God called you to do? When I was praying, I know they would ask this question. So before night I was praying and God showed me this particular verse. Come follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Like Peter, I don't have any idea what is fishers of men. So I said, Pastor, that some fishers of men is there. No, I exactly use this word. Some fishermen to fishers of men. That one, somewhere in John, somewhere. I was like, I think God called me to do that. I don't have any idea. I don't know the scripture also. And he, they were completely like, probably you need to read Bible very well. Say the God. I got admitted into the Bible College. But, you know, at that point, when I heard these words, it didn't make any sense to me. Now it really made a little sense to me. So yeah, when we see the journey of Peter throughout this, from being a fisherman, becoming a fishers of men, he is the one who traveled, how he traveled and lived with Jesus. And he's the one who was not okay to be called as a disciple. He denied Christ. Okay. And he was the one who's always with a very radical. He wants to kill someone for the Jesus sake. He wants to protect Jesus with a knife. And he's the one who was struggling like as everyone normal life. He was like living a life of disciple and he was taught by Jesus and he was amazing life story Peter has, amazing radical life story Peter has. And he's the one, when the time came, who stood in front of thousands of people and boldly preached the gospel, and 3,000 people added to the kingdom of God. Amazing, right? Who is the one who denied Christ a while, few years back? He's the one who just preached about Christ boldly. And he's the one, God used him such powerfully that when he walked, people are healed by his shadow, the touch of his shadow. So how God transformed Peter from the fisherman to fishers of men, and the journey he had and the call. And he didn't call him like a general thing. Okay, there are so many people there. He didn't call everyone, come be my disciple. He called Peter, I mean Simon, you come and follow me, be my disciple. And John was praying today, you know, in the worship. It was exactly same that what God spoke to me. He called each and every one of us by name. It's like, Lee, you are called to be my disciple. Steve, you are called to be my disciple. He didn't call, okay, guys, so 1,000 people come, be my disciple. No, he called you by name. I just want to stress that because I really feel someone needs to hear it today. He called you by name and he called you into the destiny he has prepared for you and me. And when Jesus disrupts your life, these are three things I'm just giving it, but there are so many. So he disrupts it. Like, one is he will make us to do something. He will ask us to do something out of our comfort zone. Not all the time, but yeah. I'll get a sign from Jesus. If I'm so comfortable, I will know that he's up to something. So when, and he's gonna call you by name into your destiny he has already prepared for. And I think the one thing which really touches my heart is when we obey, why we need to obey Jesus is sometimes it's really uncertain. We don't have any clear picture of what we are going to do or what is the future ahead. A lot of uncertainties right now, but Jesus knows the end from the beginning. That gives me a lot of hope. If Jesus says something, just do it, because he knows the end from the beginning. So he knows the end. If the end is not good, he will not let you do it. So if the end is not bringing glory to his name, if the end is not bringing a change in your life or transforming your life and knowing him better, he will not ask you to do it. So the amazing thing Peter did is he listened to the word of God. He listened to the voice of Jesus. And that sharp eyes, I could really imagine the sharp eyes of Jesus that pierced the heart of Peter and made him repent of his sins. So, and he just followed. So it's simple. Listen, obey, follow. It's not complicated. We might make things complicated. It might be difficult, guys. It's not easy for Peter. It's not even easy for Jesus. It might not be easy for us. That's for sure. Practically, it might not be easy for us. But it's worth it. It's worth following the word of Jesus. It's worth following his voice. And it's worth living a life for him. So, yeah. That's my disruptive Jesus. And he's amazing. There's lots to it. Maybe sometime later. So, yeah. And before closing, I wanted to share a word I just sensed in my spirit. That someone, if anyone has acne problem, mainly something related to your skin, I feel it's something related to your acne on the skin or something like that. So if anyone has anything like that, we would love to pray for you. You can just stop sharing. Me, Sanjana, is dying. I have. Okay. We will pray for them. And also before that, I want to share another word is I really feel the intensity of God's love right now. And I feel that, you know, God is calling you by name. Do not fear to step out of your boat. He will not let you drown. Get out of your boat, guys. He will not let you drown. So whoever needs to hear it, including me, I feel, let's do it. Let's press in and let's live a life with Jesus. Cool. And let's pray and close. Okay. So many people are there. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you so much that you are here right with us and you're talking to our heart, God, that you are touching our heart, and every thought which is not of yours in our minds, we just cast them out of our mind in Jesus' name right now. And we pray, God, that you help us to come out of a comfort zone. You help us to listen to your voice. You help us to respond to the call. And you help us to renew our heart by living a life with you, God. You help us to be your disciple, your worshiper, Father God. Right now, we pray for everyone who are having acne, oh Father God, every problem of acne on the skin. In Jesus' name, we speak healing and we command the skin acne problem to be healed right now. Every bacteria causing that acne, we command the bacteria to be removed right now from the skin in Jesus' name. And we speak a fresh new brand skin, oh Father God. Thank you for clearing it off in Jesus' name. And also we pray, God, every kind of emotional and mental health related issues which anyone are going through right now, God, we pray and release your amazing peace, your love, your hope and assurance. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Over. Thank you.
Hey, thanks, Ravali. Oh, wow. If you've been blessed, type an amen in the chat. Thank you, Ravali, for just ministering to us. I can listen to people talking about Jesus all day and night. He's awesome. So, guys, I really hope you've been blessed. I want to encourage you to do this, okay, as an exercise whenever you can. In the Gospels, right, you know, there's these Bibles that has a red letter Bible. I mean, the red letters are the ones which every word Jesus has spoken, right? Pick a Gospel, any Gospel, any one of the four, and just read the red letters. Just read the words that Jesus, and then see if you can imagine, for example, I mean, I was revisiting the Gospels a few years ago, and it just felt like we just rushed through it without even thinking much. But then I actually paused and imagined this very scripture, what you shared, Ravali, is what would have his voice sounded like when he said, follow me. And, you know, and this is not an idea. It's not a science fiction book. This is a real person. This is your king. This is my king. Okay. None of us have had, I can't speak for everyone, but then I don't think all of us have had the privilege of bowing down before a physical, a natural king. But hey, you know, he is our king. And if, just to imagine what his voice would have sounded like. Imagine this, if Jesus would have not, you know, named Lazarus or called Lazarus by his name, every dead person from the grave would have walked out. Like that. That's the power in his, you know, in his, but yeah, I mean, sure. That's, I just want to leave you all of that. When you can pick a Gospel, just read the red letter and imagine, let the Holy Spirit breathe to you. Okay. But that's about it. I want to thank you all guys for joining in, taking the time out tonight. I look forward for this time. I really do. It's so much fun to see you all, kind of face to face, but yeah. All right. One more thing. Next Saturday, right, JP, we have this quiz happening on Genesis 2 and 3. Some of us just realized that Genesis 1 is just more than creation, and God said, let there be light. Well, next Saturday, the quiz is happening on Genesis 2 and 3. Okay, so if you haven't registered, signed up already, go ahead and register right away. Okay, it's going to be awesome. It's going to be good fun. Sahil, sign up, okay?
Sahil is too comfy.
I can see that. All right, guys, that's about it for tonight. Have a good night's rest, okay? See you all soon. Take care. Live long and prosper, Josh. Bye.
Bye. Good night.
Good night. Good night.
Thank you, Ravali.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ravali.
Thank you, Ravali.
Hey, thank you.
What happened, Ravali? Why didn't you say anything?